Porcupine Tree are back. It's been 12 years since the last Porcupine Tree album, and honestly, I wasn't sure if we'd ever hear more music from them, so this is a very welcome surprise. I love Stephen Wilson's solo albums and the other projects the members have been a part of, such as The Pineapple Thief, but Porcupine Tree has a certain energy and sound and a vibe that really speaks to me. And part of this is that they were one of the most influential bands for my growth as a musician when I was younger. Definitely a top 10 band for me. This new song, Herodin, is really great, and it has a lot of the musical elements of Porcupine Tree that I really enjoy. Apparently this song has been sitting around since 2009-ish, so I don't think this is necessarily brand new material, but it's really nice to hear some Porcupine Tree with modern 2021 production, and with the evolution that each of the three members have made since 2009. Before I get into this, go ahead and subscribe and hit the bell notification. This is The Prog School, where I dig deep into the theory and techniques behind progressive rock and metal. So let's break this whole thing down. It starts off with a killer bass line. And this is a Porcupine Tree staple, to have the bass driving the groove. I think of songs like Halo. Or Three. Or Hate Song. Now, unfortunately, it looks like Colin Edwin is not a part of this recording, which is a bit of a bummer, but the bass sounds really good regardless, and I believe that Stephen Wilson may have played the bass himself, although I'm not entirely sure on that. The first thing to talk about is the rhythm. The majority of this song is in 5-4. Here's the main groove played by my good friend Esteban Roybal, who you'll see a lot more of on this channel in the near future. Gavin Harrison might be the best drummer in the world when it comes to making odd time signatures groove. I actually have a whole video on his incredible grooves. Notice the backbeats on beat 2 and 5 here, and the hi-hat accents on each quarter note. Porcupine Tree have a lot of songs that groove on odd time signatures. The start of Something Beautiful, which is in 9. Of course, The Sound of Music, which is in 7. And The Blind House, which is in 5. Honestly, if you were to play this song for someone with no musical background, I don't think they would notice anything weird about the groove. And that's a testament to how well the guys in Porcupine Tree execute these kind of grooves. And that comes from doing these kind of rhythms a lot and feeling very comfortable with them. Harmonically, in the intro and verses, we have a tonal center of B. And the reason I'm saying a tonal center of B and not the key of B minor, for instance, is that it's kind of weaving between different sounds in B. The intro bass riff is very clearly in B natural minor. But in the keys, there are a lot of F naturals happening. And that's the flat 5 in B. There's also quite a few C naturals happening, like at the end of the first chorus in the keyboards. And C is the flat 2 in B, and that invokes a Phrygian sound. So it's moving between these different dark minor sounds. The flat 2 and the flat 5 are classic intervals for achieving that dark, melancholy vibe, which is a staple of Porcupine Tree. And my guess would be that they laid down this foundation of B with the bass riff, and then added these different sounds on top of it, especially with the ambient keyboards, which is one of my favorite elements of Porcupine Tree, and they're better than ever on this song. If you keep the same root note for a long time, it's actually pretty easy to move between different scales and modes over top of that. So we'll do natural minor, Phrygian, the flat five. I can mix all those together. The vocal melody here is all coming from B minor pentatonic, so there's a very safe and inside sounding melody grounding things, and that way the keyboard textures can play around with the harmony on top of it. Then it moves to what I'm going to call the pre-chorus. And here it moves to being rooted on E instead of B. E is the fourth of B, so it's a very natural move, but it makes this section feel very different from everything else so far. And it continues this Phrygian kind of sound. Over top of the E, we have E, F, G, and A flat, which is also the beginning of the half whole diminished scale. So we have a little bit of that sound as well. But the vocal melody is coming right from E Phrygian. The fifth of each of these ascending notes is actually playing in the keyboard, so what you have is basically power chords over this E. And once again, it's this idea of bringing in different sounds over a droning root note. These first three chords all come from E Phrygian, but the A flat power chord doesn't. And I'm just doing this as a dark sounding chromatic move. I know Stephen Wilson doesn't have a heavy theory background and is mostly using his ears here, so I don't want to overanalyze this. Now it's on to the chorus. It stays in 5-4 here, but it's grouped a little bit differently. This is based off one of the most common 5-4 rhythms. Eighth notes grouped is 3-3-2-2. You sometimes hear this called the Mission Impossible rhythm. I talked about this one in my 10 odd meters you need to know video. But here these groups of three, which are dotted quarter notes, get split in half to make four dotted eighth notes. Essentially you get four dotted eighth notes in the space of three quarter notes, a 4-against-3 feel in the first three beats of these 5-4 bars. Something like this. 1-2-3-4-5. 1-2-3-4. 1-2-3-4. Harmonically, it moves to D major here, which is the relative major of B minor. First, it's a measure of D suspended to D. Then a measure of A suspended to A. Then back to the intro, B minor, Phrygian, flat five kind of a sound. Moving to the major sound here gives the chorus a completely different feel from the rest of the song, which really helps it stand out. And Stephen Wilson does like to go to major sometimes, songs like Trains or Lazarus, and somehow he's able to still make it sound sad, even if it's in major. And the change in the groove here is super effective as well. Then we get a repeat of the verse, pre-chorus, and chorus with everything up a little in dynamics. And the second verse is half as long as the first verse, which is a classic writing trick. The first verse being longer really establishes the groove and mood of the song, making it more natural to get back to the chorus quicker the second time. After the second chorus, it moves to what I'm going to call the vocal bridge, and that's this acoustic-led section. It's the time of the almost rain without you. I am in debt tonight. I'm gone. Porcupine Tree have a lot of acoustic-led songs or sections of songs. Trains, Lips of Ashes, The Verse of Blackest Eyes, I could think of dozens of other examples. This acoustic section in Herodin is a very effective break from the more driving groove of the rest of the song, and it helps to lead to the next heavy section in a very natural way. And acoustic sections like this are a big part of bands like Pink Floyd, and even heavier bands like Opeth, which is no surprise since Michael Ackerfeldt and Stephen Wilson have worked together a lot. This part is still in 5-4, and once again taking advantage of this Mission Impossible rhythm. This is by far the easiest 5-4 rhythm to feel and groove along to. The harmony here moves to firmly in B natural minor, whereas the verses used a lot of different minor sounds, the Phrygian and flat 5, and this is making this part feel different from the rest of the song, much more consonant and melodic. The chords go as follows, G major 7, F sharp minor, G major 7, E minor, F sharp minor, G, F sharp minor, E minor, F sharp minor, G, D major 7, to D major 7 sharp 11. All of this is in B natural minor except that last chord, which I'll talk about in a second. The vocal melody here is really hammering chord tones, and it's a very well-constructed melody that follows the chords and rhythm in a very pleasing way. So it lands on D major 7, and then the fifth of D major 7 A, goes down to G sharp, and you get a D major 7 sharp 11. And this is kind of working like a suspension like we have in the chorus, but usually a suspension resolves from non-chord tones to a chord tone. And in this case, it's a chord tone to a non-chord tone. And I think it would have worked to just hold on the D major 7, but adding that dissonant resolution makes it feel uneasy, which sets up the next part of the song really well and mirrors the lyrical content of What Is Left Without You. Not exactly an uplifting lyric. And what is left without you? Now we get a long instrumental section. This is where it goes away from 5-4 and goes to 6-4, which I'm feeling like a slow 6-8. We get this muted guitar riff, which kind of mirrors the opening bass riff before it kicks into the heaviness. I would guess the guitar here is standard tuning with the E string dropped to a low B, because I've never seen Steven Wilson use a 7-string guitar. It's a pretty cool tuning if that's what's being used. And this riff is just B minor pentatonic with big dotted quarter notes. One of my favorite elements of Porcupine Tree are these super heavy riffs they go into, the middle of Anesthetize or songs like Shallow or Open Car. They use heaviness to great effect, especially since it's not something that happens all the time in their music. Alternating with this heavy riff, we get a variation on the pre-chorus with that Phrygian diminished sound over an E root. It's a cool way to bring this idea back, and it plays off the heavy riff really nicely. From here it moves to the most interesting part of the song to me, this guitar, keyboard, vocal, unison melody that happens over a 5-4 groove and has some very unusual note choices. Once again, it's rooted on B here, and it starts very clearly in B Phrygian. Then we get the flat 5 again, into this very cool descending chromatic thing using a major 7 chord with no third. It starts on G sharp and moves chromatically down to F sharp, and then finally to an E minor chord. There's no reason for me to overanalyze this. Essentially, it's just a shape moving chromatically down, and it has this cool falling-like sound. And it's more of this idea of outside sounds while being clearly rooted on B for most of this section. This floating melody on top of the driving 5-4 groove works really well. That part happens twice, and then there's a short transition section before going back to the chorus. Here we get the pre-chorus vocal melody, but instead of a root note of E like the pre-chorus, it's rooted on B, so this melody plays off the rhythm instruments a little bit differently. And it's more of this diminished sound, but this time rooted on B. So we have B, C, D, F, and E flat. Then the chorus plays twice, with the melody happening in a guitar and keyboard the second time instead of the vocals, and there's this massive drum fill between the two choruses. Kevin Harrison is a beast. The song finishes with the vocal bridge section, this time with no drums or bass, and it ends on that unresolved D major 7 sharp 11. So there you have it, a full breakdown of the new Porcupine Tree song, Harridan. I'm super stoked that we're getting new Porcupine Tree music, and I'm really excited to hear the rest of this album. What are your favorite Porcupine Tree albums and songs? Please let me know in the comments. As always, if you enjoyed this lesson, subscribe, hit the bell notification, like, comment, share. Till next time, stay proggy.